Chief of Corporate Communications at the Central Bank of Barbados. And joining me today is Governor Cleviston Haynes. Welcome, Governor. Today, our governor will be reviewing Barbados' economic performance for the 2018 and, of course, sharing with us his forecast for 2019. We are joined in the executive dining room of the Central Bank of Barbados by our media corps. But before we get to the questions, I invite you to view this video synopsis of our economic performance.
Good day. Today I'm reviewing Barbados' economic performance for 2018 and sharing the bank's forecast for 2019. 2018 was challenging for the Barbados economy. Economic activity remained sluggish, but the decision to enter a four-year economic adjustment program with the IMF, the suspension of commercial external debt payments, and the restructuring of government's domestic debt renewed confidence and contributed to an improvement in the public finances and the stock of international reserves. Government unveiled its Economic Recovery and Transformation Plan, which aims to deepen the fiscal adjustment effort and to undertake structural reforms to stimulate medium-term economic growth. The public finances strengthened, as evidenced by the timely payment of current year tax refunds, the curtailing of new central government arrears, and reduced reliance on central bank financing. The completion of the domestic debt restructuring and the enhanced outlook for fiscal and debt sustainability over the medium term contributed to an upgrade in Barbados' credit rating for domestic securities. Structural reforms have proceeded apace, with new legislation to strengthen oversight of state-owned enterprises and to modernize the Town and Country Planning Office now being debated in Parliament. In addition, the government reformed the corporate tax regime in response to the OECD's base erosion and profit shifting initiative. This resulted in a comprehensive amendment to the tax structure for the international and domestic corporate sectors. Real economic activity contracted by 0.6% in 2018, as moderate gains in tourism were outweighed by the fall off in manufacturing and other services. Tourism output slowed to an estimated 0.6% from 2.2% in 2017. Long stay arrivals were 2.8% higher than the previous year, owing to intensive marketing and an increase in airlift. However, the expansion in the sector was contained because the average length of stay declined, a result of the increase in the shorter staying visitors from the United States market. Arrivals from Canada and the United Kingdom were both up, with the latter recovering from a mild reduction in the previous year. Construction fell by approximately 7% following moderate growth in 2017. This outturn reflected low levels of infrastructural development in the public and private sectors, evidenced by reduced quarrying, cement consumption, and lower imports of other construction materials. The average unemployment rate for the four quarters ending September was 9.2% compared to 10.2% a year earlier. However, public sector layoffs impacted unemployment in the fourth quarter. The uptick in the 12-month moving average measure of inflation tapered off during the second half of the year. Imported commodity food prices remained stable, but the pass-through effects from the 2017 hike in the NSRL, together with rising oil prices, pushed up inflation during the first half of the year. The elimination of the NSRL and the softening in international fuel prices in the fourth quarter helped to contain the inflation rate to 3.7%. The international reserves, which had declined since 2012, increased by $576 million to $1.05 billion at year-end, the highest level since March 2013, and equivalent to 13.5 weeks of import cover. This outcome was initially influenced by improved availability of foreign exchange that allowed FX dealers to increase their sales of foreign exchange to the central bank, and by the savings from the suspension of debt service that enabled reserves to stabilize, particularly during the middle of the year when they were critically low. During the last quarter, capital inflows for policy and project loans of over $470 million from international financial institutions boosted foreign exchange holdings further. The improved performance of the foreign exchange market reflected higher net private sector inflows and a modest improvement in the external current account deficit to 3.8% of GDP. Rising tourism earnings aided in narrowing the deficit as the sector benefited from higher arrivals and improved room rates. Domestic exports were flat as the gains from exports of chemicals and printed paper labels were outstripped by declines in rum and sugar exports. Total imports fell just under 2% as non-oil purchases declined for the second consecutive year. Capital goods and non-oil intermediate goods contracted as imports of both machinery and construction materials declined. Consumer goods also fell by 3.3%, following a 7.1% reduction the previous year. The decline was partly related to lower motor vehicle imports and furniture. The public finances between April and December 2018 improved significantly. Reduced interest costs associated with the suspension of commercial external debt payments and lower interest rates on domestic government securities, effective October 1, contributed to the outturn. However, the fiscal outturn also benefited from non-interest expenditure that was lower than originally targeted, resulting from reduced transfers and lower capital expenditure. Revenues were $56 million below the target due to larger than anticipated tax refunds, the impact of lower imports, and a lag in the collection of some of the recently implemented budgetary measures. Government provided refunds of $54 million in income tax and $18 million in the value-added tax, resulting in lower than anticipated net earnings from income tax and VAT. Excise revenue and import duties also declined. However, the new fuel tax realized $35 million during the period. Revenue from property taxes surpassed the target by $17 million, given the collection from the tax amnesty. Corporate taxes also overperformed, despite $26 million in refunds owing to significant first-time payments by recently registered international business companies. The foreign exchange fee yielded $56 million in tax receipts over the period. The suspension of debt service and the improved fiscal outturn helped the government to reverse the reliance on domestic funding that had been a feature of the financial landscape in recent years. Policy-based loans of $350 million from the IDB and CDB during the last quarter of the year contributed to an overall decline in central bank financing of approximately $242 million. In contrast, the increase registered in the first half of the fiscal year. Discussions on the debt restructuring related to foreign currency denominated claims on the public sector are ongoing. However, the domestic debt restructuring allowed government to erase approximately $2.9 billion, or 29% of GDP, from the stock of debt held by the public sector institutions. The gross public sector debt is now equivalent to 127% of GDP. The debt restructuring and the adoption of new accounting standard IFRS 9 eroded capital in the financial services sector. However, commercial banks held adequate capital as indicated by the capital adequacy ratio of 15.6%. Liquidity in the banking system remained high, with an excess cash ratio of 16% compared with 14% in the corresponding period of 2017. The excess securities ratio also increased, partly because the improved fiscal position allowed the bank to reduce commercial bank securities requirement ratio from 20% to 17.5%. Credit to the non-financial private sector declined by approximately 0.5%. The distribution sector increased their borrowings, while loans to the real estate and to hotels and restaurants declined. And now for the outlook. In 2019, government must build on the progress in restoring macroeconomic stability and engendering confidence. Efficient and timely execution of the reforms identified in the adjustment program related to tax policy, revenue administration, SOE reforms, and business facilitation will be crucial in helping the economy to return to a sustainable growth path. Over the past decade, average growth was minus 0.7%. Revitalizing growth is therefore critical, but the forecast of 2019 is for growth to remain flat. Tourism is expected to perform favorably due to an anticipated expansion of airlift, special events like the English cricket tour, and an increase in ships docking at the port. This activity will be supported by the thrust towards Barbados emerging as a hub for medical education. The need to sustain the fiscal consolidation effort could continue to dampen economic activity. However, this trend can be reversed through higher levels of private sector investment. Several projects in the tourism, healthcare, and distribution sectors have been identified for startup in 2019. The actual commencement date of these projects will influence the degree of expansion in real economic activity. significant downside risks remain. In particular, the forecast for global growth, including our major source markets, has been revised downwards by the IMF from 3.7% to 3.5%. The US economy is forecast to grow by 2.6% this year, but the uncertainty related to trade tensions lingers. The latest Brexit developments can also impact economic activity in the UK, with potential effects on the pound sterling. Geopolitical factors could alter the outlook for international oil prices, influencing economic activity and an otherwise benign inflation environment. The revenue measures announced in the latter part of 2018 will have a full year impact in fiscal year 2019-2020 as government strives to achieve its targeted primary surplus of 6% of GDP. However, government must continue to manage its expenditure to avoid any shortfalls in its targeted goals. The external debt suspension has helped to shore up reserves, and completion of the restructuring remains important to the overall stabilization effort. Placing the debt on a downward trajectory and creating fiscal space will allow for the gradual reduction in outstanding arrears to the private sector and strengthen the medium-term growth potential. These developments should contribute to a further improvement in credit ratings. Effective program implementation will facilitate additional access to funds from the multilateral agencies. These resources should enable the reserve cover to continue to grow in 2019. The road ahead remains challenging, but the commitment of the government and all Barbadians to continue the critical structural reforms will position the economy to overcome these hurdles and strengthen economic sustainability. I thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. There you have it, our review of the performance for 2018 and our outlook for 2019. I now invite the media to field their questions. I invite Mr. Joel Brathwaite of the Barbados Advocate to be the first to get going. Joel?
Hello. Good morning. Governor, the last time you were with us, the Barbados economy had contracted by 0.5%. And you're back here now with us again to review the economy for 2018. And I'm seeing that the economy contracted by a further 1%. Could you tell us what would have happened in the last quarter of 2018 to reflect that 0.6% decline?
So that's 0.1 rather than 1%. No, I think the major change there is I think the tourism was slightly weaker than we would have had at the end of September. So you would see that the rate of growth of tourism has fallen to about 0.6% itself, which was weaker than what we had previously. And that largely explains the situation. Part of that is due to, I think, a softening of arrivals during the month of December. And there was also some weakening of the cruise sector. But of course, the cruise sector is relatively small in the overall scope of the assessment of the performance of the tourism sector.
Nothing on screen.
Now, the main talking point in the economy in 2018
has been the agreement the country has concluded with the International Monetary Fund. And the thing is that from where I sit, I'm getting a whole set of conflicting views about that agreement. I know it is said that the agreement would be for 4 years, but then I'm hearing, well, the former Prime Minister suggesting that it is going to be a 15-year agreement, and other people saying 10-year agreement. A 10-year agreement. Could you set the record straight for once as to what is the real situation with that agreement?
Well, all I can say is that the government has signed a 4-year agreement with the International Monetary Fund. The hope and expectation is that by the end of that 4-year period, that we would have made sufficient progress both in addressing our fiscal issues, in restoring the foreign exchange situation, in bringing debt down on a trajectory that we believe will take it towards the 60% by 2033. And from that perspective, we would be in a position to manage our affairs on our own from the end of that 4-year period. As to what happens after the four-year period, I think it's a little early for us to speculate as to whether or not one will be into a 10 or 15-year program cycle. If you go back to, let's say, the early 1990s, you would know we had a three-year program, and we were able to come out at the end of that. But one has to look at the challenges that you face at a particular point in time to determine whether or not you need more support after the four-year period. But certainly, I think we have gone into this with the expectation and the plan to limit this to a four-year program.
Sean?
Good morning, Governor. Sean Cumberbatch from The Nation. Can you give us an assessment of how the BERT plan and the complementary IMF program, how they have gone so far, whether we have attained our targets up to the end of last month? Also, what are some of those key targets, including the foreign reserves? And what can Barbadians expect this year as far as that is concerned, related to other measures they might have to bear?
Okay. So far, progress has been encouraging. I think, obviously, what stands out is where we are in terms of our international reserves, both in gross terms and net terms, because the program target is actually set as the net international reserves, and that is over 850 million. You would see that our net domestic assets are also doing quite well because of the improvement in the net international reserves as a corresponding decline in the net domestic assets. We have seen a significant improvement in the fiscal performance. What we provided for you are sort of provisional data. We're still compiling, trying to finalize the data on the fiscal, but certainly what we've seen is a substantial improvement in the fiscal performance. And with the debt restructuring, we've been able to bring the overall stock of debt down, and that I think is within the program limits. Now, that progress, as I said in the press release, has to be continued during this quarter and into fiscal 2019-2020. As you know, a key barometer of the program is a fiscal primary surplus of 6% of GDP for fiscal year 2019-2020. So the government is in the process now of designing its fiscal program for the year. Now, clearly, there are a number of measures that were introduced during the, let's say, post-June 2018, which did not have a full year effect. And what will happen now is that these measures will now have a full year effect and help to boost the overall revenue take. There are some measures which, if you look in the BERT program, to which they alluded, particularly trying to generate more revenue from the gambling sector. The online tax is supposed to come on stream in the next few months. So those would also generate additional revenue to help you to transition from where you are with a surplus of 3.3% in 2018-19 to the targeted 6% in 2019-20. Beyond that, the fiscal reforms, which have started, I would say, in terms of expenditure, and as you know, a number of those things, we've had some layoffs, both in the central government as well as in the statutory bodies, that will give rise to savings. The government has been looking at a number of the contracts which it previously had to identify potential savings in those areas. So these are things which are going to help to control the expenditure and to bring it down. So based on where we are at present in terms of moving towards that 3.3% of GDP for fiscal year 2018-2019, based on the combination of measures that have already been put in place, then we're looking towards the 2019-2020 to see a stronger fiscal position and achieving the targeted 6% of GDP.
Sean, you have another question?
Just to follow up. One thing we haven't concluded yet is the debt restructuring for the foreign creditors. How soon would you like to see that completed? And basically, how far along are we in terms of concluding that?
Well, first, how soon I would like to see it completed, I'd like to see it completed today. But I think it's a process. We are negotiating in good faith with the external creditors, and we hope to be able to arrive at a consensual position as soon as possible. I think we have to go through the process to make sure that everyone is aligned, they understand our issues, we understand their issues, and that we're able to come to a position which ultimately will redound to the benefit of the Barbadian economy, and that will, and that they themselves will feel comfortable. So, you know, let us take this step by step in order to achieve that ultimate goal.
Roberta?
Roberta Dowell, Starcom Network. The decision to converge local and international tax rates was supposed to bring Barbados up to OECD standards, which we understand. But there are some reports of some offshore companies closing here in Barbados. How then does government plan to encourage international companies to come here and grow that sector? And then also, what are the real growth strategies of the government? We hear a lot of talk about cutting expenditure across the board, which we understand, mm-hmm. but what are the real growth strategies beyond taxing, taxation, sorry.
Okay, so as it relates to the international business sector, and obviously one would have to get a sense as to whether these are large entities or small entities to which you refer. What was hoped when this decision was taken to converge the taxes is that it would eliminate any incentive that international business companies might have to be able to move out of the jurisdiction because of the threats which the OECD posed for the country. We do believe that the structure that has been put in place will enable us to keep certainly the large taxpaying entities which contribute to our fiscal revenues and which contribute to employment of our skilled nationals, as well as the building of foreign exchange. We think that that is going to remain. Will we lose some companies? It's possible. But we believe that there is sufficient in there for us to be able to sustain the sector. Now, as it relates to your other question on growth, I think that's a multidimensional issue. The fiscal and structural adjustment is a critical component of getting growth going forward. As we say in the press release, we've gone through a decade where the economy has declined on average almost 1% per annum. That is a situation we need to turn around. And to turn it around, we have to address the structural weaknesses, we have to address the fiscal issues, because what that has contributed to is a loss of confidence, and therefore, in order to generate growth going forward, you really have to create confidence among your potential investors. The structural reforms that are part of the program are designed to, on the one hand, enhance competitiveness and to strengthen business facilitation. That is an issue that has dogged us in recent years, where we've been criticized quite heavily for business facilitation. And therefore, it's important that we get these structural measures in place so as to strengthen the facilitation. Beyond that, there are the issues that we deal with on the sectoral aspect. So, we just alluded to the whole issue of taxation and the impact that it has both on the international business, but it also has a potential to impact the domestic sector. Because now what you have effectively done is that you have made it more attractive for domestic businesses. And one of the things that one will hope that will spin out of this ultimately is that there will be improved and increased investment from the domestic private sector in addition to the international sector that which we want to attract. For, in terms of growth strategies, as I said, there are a number of things. We have to focus now on how can we strengthen the performance of existing sectors So we talk tourism, we talk international business. As you know, there's now a new thrust towards creating a niche in medical education. So that will act as part of what we do to strengthen growth going forward. The whole issue of alternative energy, both in terms of enhancing competitiveness of other sectors, but also as a growth industry in itself. The whole focus on creative industries. So there are a number of aspects to the development, which I think if you review the BERT document, you will see reference. And then it has to be supplemented by key infrastructural development, because being able to generate growth over the medium term means that we have to have an infrastructure that investors find comfortable and convenient. So the work, for example, as it relates to the sewage, trying to address the sewage issues, is an important element of the infrastructural work necessary to ensure that we're able to drive growth over the medium term.
Roberta, you have a follow-up?
Yes. This one I actually heard on the call-in program, and I thought it was a really important question to ask. With all the public sector layoffs, and you just spoke about the ease of doing business and business facilitation, the structure of government has in effect changed when you lay off workers. What is being done to ensure that we are more efficient, even though there have been layoffs? How does the central bank think government should address this?
Well, that essentially is an issue of organizational reform. I think there are two aspects to it. I think once you lay a person off, you have to look to see what were they doing, how can that be done more efficiently with the limited resources that you now have. And a focal point of this has to be a sort of what we call a digital transformation of how government does business. You have to be able to rely more on your digital system. So if it's, and I think you will see a lot more of this in the months ahead, issues that say of collecting revenue. Can you collect more of your revenue using digital means? So you have a back office which is perhaps involved with reconciliations and so on, because you have numerous transactions to deal with. Whereas if you have a digital solution, while you still have reconciliation to do, your tasks may become a lot easier, and therefore by digitizing a lot of what we do, then we're able to deliver the services either on a more timely or on a more efficient basis. So it really calls for organizational reform. And I think the government is very keen on promoting such reforms in order to be able to deliver services more efficiently, because I think you're very right. Once we have effected layoffs, we still have to deliver the services which we have promised the public. Alternatively, then you would have to be looking to outsource some services if you are unable to deliver them in the way that to which we were accustomed. In fact, we want to be able to do it better than we are accustomed.
Joel?
Mr. Governor, we are into 2019, and I'm wondering what is the next, when are we going to make the next drawdown from the International Monetary Fund, and what we have to do in order to be able to make that drawdown?
Well, in relation to the last question, there are certain targets that we have. I sort of outlined in broad measure what those targets were in NAR, NDA, fiscal, primary balance, the debt, transfers to enterprises. Those are the primary ones. There are one, two other targets, and these are all set out in the IMF report, which would have been issued back in, I think, October last year. The next drawdown comes probably around June or so, because in about May, we will have a review. As you know, the IMF comes periodically to visit us. They're going to come visit in early February, but they're going to come back around early May to do a review on our end of March performance. And it's at that time that they will do the review. They will take a a report to the board, and once we have been able to deliver on the targets that we have committed ourselves to deliver on, then it's at that point that we become eligible for the next drawdown. So as I said, I anticipate that somewhere around early June.
In terms though of those things which we have to do, looking at the state-owned enterprises that we are talking about, restructuring and that sort of stuff, do you anticipate though that it would be a tough program to implement, given the fact that it could involve a whole set of new layoffs in the economy?
Restructuring is never easy. And I don't think we should delude ourselves that this is going to be easy. Tough decisions have to be taken. As you know, the government has already identified some layoffs, both in central government as well as state-owned enterprises. But I think they're also looking at other means. I mentioned the whole question of trying to reduce the size of some of their contracts so as to be able to contain costs. Because what you want ultimately to do is, you know, we have a fiscal problem, we have to address the fiscal problem, but as Roberta intimated, we also want to be able to improve the quality of service. And therefore, it's not all about layoffs, but there will, you know, there have been, and there will be some layoffs as part of the process, but we have to strengthen the capacity of these organizations to be able to, on the one hand, contain their costs, but also we have to look at, in some cases, not all, the whole question of their ability to collect revenue to finance their own activities. Because the government being in a position where it cannot provide all of the funding which it did previously, and therefore, when you look at the organizations, one has to look at both aspects. One is the cost side, but one also has to look at the revenue side. How efficient, and it doesn't necessarily mean increased tariffs, although it could, but how efficient are we in collecting the revenue, for example, that we are supposed to collect? And that is an area that we have to focus on going forward, because that will influence the nature and the scale of the adjustment that is undertaken.
Sean, sorry, go ahead, Joel.
Yeah, I want to zero in on the debt position, because I saw in the press release that you issued today that the debt to GDP ratio has fallen to 126% of GDP. And I'm wondering to what extent that decline had to do with the rebasing of the economy last year. I know
rebasing about GDP?
Yeah, rebasing of GDP. I know it is said in the press release that, you know, we restructure the debt and things, but the average person would tell you that, okay, we did borrow a lot in 2018, and in much we did borrow, we borrowed at lower interest rates. But to what extent, though, that rebasing of GDP had a hand in helping to bring that debt to GDP ratio down?
Well, the rebasing would already have been factored into the numbers that we were talking about. Remember, earlier in the year, we were talking about 157% of GDP. So that would already have been factored in. So what you are seeing now in terms of going from the 157 to roughly about 126, 127 is the impact of the restructuring itself and not the rebasing. If you were comparing, let's say, 2016 or 2017 and 2018, earlier in the year, then you could attribute it to some rebasing, but not, I don't think it was that significant, but that is when you would want to make that comparison.
If I may stay on that
sure.
trajectory, I'm seeing that for 2018, mm-hmm. nominal GDP is over $10 billion. Mm-hmm. For 2017, it would have been $9 billion.
9 billion,
but it's more in 2018, at the end of 2018. When I apply things like external current account deficit, fiscal deficit, seeing debt to GDP, mm-hmm. that higher nominal GDP mm-hmm. is giving you some kind of leeway that will make those indicators smaller.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't want to describe it as leeway, but it's part of the natural process that if the economy grows in nominal terms, then it will have an impact on the ratios that you'll compare, whether you're comparing the fiscal deficit, the external current mm-hmm. account, the debt to GDP ratio. So, and therefore, one of the things you hope ultimately to be able to do, in a sense, would be almost to grow yourself out of your debt problem. Because you know, reaching your 60% target is not going to be driven solely by the size of the primary balances, although that's an important aspect. It's not going to be driven solely by the size of the primary balances that you're able to realize, but it's also going to be driven by the extent to which you're able to grow the economy. So in other words, if we, over the medium term, we're not able to grow the economy, and it just stood at the $10 billion to which you refer, that debt ratio would not come down. So we have to be able, as one of our objectives, to be able to grow the economy.
Sean.
Governor, under current expenditure, the only category there that increased between April and December was wages and salaries. Mm-hmm. We know there was a public sector wage increase, but there was also a number of public sector job retrenchments. Can you explain why wages and salaries would have increased and between April and December? And in 2019, this first quarter, is it your anticipation we will see that increase further, or are you expecting that to fall?
In terms of the April to December performance, I think you allude to the fact that there was this, remember, this 5% wage increase, which would go back to April. So that would be like a 9-month contribution to the overall stock of wages. Notwithstanding the fact that there would have been some layoffs in the fourth quarter, I think that would also be offset by some of the retrenchment costs associated with those layoffs. So that's like a one-time effect that you would get at the point when the layoffs actually occur. So over time, we anticipate that the wages will stabilize, because once you've had let's say by the time you get to April, you've had the full year effect of the wage increase, and you've had now the effect of the layoffs, you'll then begin to see some reduction in wages. The only adjustment, of course, would be, of course, you have to make adjustment for certain cash payments that may not have been made early in 2018, because as you know, we were still having some cash difficulties at the early part of the financial year. So that will be a slightly different scenario when we go into 2019, 2020, where we now have to account for those, because those will be, accounted for on a timely basis.
Shakira?
Good morning, Governor. Sharika Griffith from CBC. As you know, Barbados does not exist within a vacuum, and the report notes that the global growth is forecast to fall by at least 0.2%. How much of a concern is that, given the impact that it could have on the country's economy?
At this point, I wouldn't say we're too concerned. I think the magnitude of the contraction in the global growth forecast is still relatively small, but it's something that we have to monitor. As you say, we don't live in a world of our own, and if international growth contracts significantly, then it will impact our economy. As you know, we're tourism-based, and a lot of the demand for our tourism is partly driven by what is happening to persons' income and persons' wealth in international, in overseas countries. So if income and wealth contracts there, it could have an adverse impact on demand for our tourism product, and therefore that could impact negatively our overall growth prospects. But at this point, I wouldn't say to you that the contraction from 3.7 to 3.5 is unduly worrying at this point in time.
Roberta.
Just a quick one here. I see in your release that revenues were $56 million below the target due to larger than anticipated tax refunds. How is government dealing with that? I'm sure that these savings would have made some contribution somewhere. What was the initial target, first of all, and how is government dealing with the, I don't want to say disappointing, but not reaching that target? And then also, I see here the foreign exchange fee yielded $56 million in tax receipts over that period. Is that within the target range that government anticipated? And if not, does it make sense keeping it?
All right. So your first question in terms of the revenue, and I think if you just add 56 to the actual turn, that will, because I don't have the figure at the top, that will give you a sense as to what the target for the period was. Clearly, as you go forward, there are things that happen that you did not necessarily anticipate, and you have to adjust towards those. And where the adjustment comes in the short term is obviously that you have to be tighter on your expenditure in order to be able to make sure that you're able to make up for that shortfall. Your second question?
My second one was the FX fee.
Oh, the FX fee. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The FX fee is broadly in line with expectations. As you know, it's a fee that is based on the use of foreign exchange by locals. And that has tended to be fairly, since it's implemented in 2017, it has tended to be very consistent. Now, as to whether or not one were to sort of eliminate it, I think one has to look at the broader issue of tax reform. And when we come to deal with the issue of tax reform, then we would determine what taxes we want to maintain and what tax rates we want to apply, to the extent that you might want to, you know, when we introduced the VAT, for example, in the late 90s, we were able to absorb several taxes into one. So I wouldn't want at this stage to be talking about individual taxes and eliminating individual taxes. I think we have to take a broader issue of what do we want to achieve with our tax reform, both in terms of generating revenue, but at the same time creating incentives, being efficient, and enabling us to attract the type of business that we want to attract.
Sean.
Governor, there have been some numbers being bandied about, for lack of a better phrase, over there in terms of the English cricket tour. From the central bank's position, what is your assessment on what contribution that will make to our economy this year?
I'll be honest with you, I haven't done a computation of that magnitude to be able to say to you that it will generate 40, 60, 80. We do know that when the British come, that it has a significant impact on the foreign exchange flows, because they do come and they do spend. There's some products that certainly benefit from their presence here, but I wouldn't want to mislead you and say to you that the figures that are being bandied about are too high or too low.
Joel.
Could you say whether we have any foreign debt repayments to be made this year? And if we do have, could you say who we will be making those payments to, and how much?
At this point in time, as you know, we continue to service our multilateral debt. What we have suspended is our external commercial debt. But we continue to service our multilateral debt, and that will continue. The actual outturn as it relates to our external commercial will depend on the nature of any restructuring that occurs in the upcoming months. So depending on how that pans out will determine what additional external debt service we will have to pay. But at this point, the multilateral continues to be serviced on time. And you know, we've gotten some relief in terms of the accumulation of reserves by the suspension, but we are quite cognizant that we now have to await the actual restructuring to determine where we go from here.
Sean, you have another question?
Yes. In terms of the debt restructuring, most of the talk is surrounds the impact on companies, individuals, but from the central bank's point of view, what impact has that had on the bank in terms of debt associated with the bank?
On the impact on the central bank?
Yes, yes.
Well, as you're aware, in recent years, we would have financed government substantially, and therefore we accumulated a large stock of treasury bills and longer term securities, predominantly treasury bills. And part of the debt restructuring was for us to write down some of those securities. We have been, like everybody else, have been issued with some securities, which will enable us, from an income perspective, we believe to be able to continue to pay our way, but it's been a significant reduction in the assets and therefore in the capital of the bank. And as you are aware, we are looking at how we will recapitalize the bank over the medium term, because it's not something that we can do overnight. But that has been the major impact on the bank, that its capital has been impacted by the fact that much of the securities that it held have been written down.
As a follow-up.
Sean Benjua, yeah.
Yes, just a quick follow-up to that. Can you give us a sense on what recapitalization would entail?
Well, we have to find a means of injecting funds into the bank such that the capital is repaired. We have not yet resolved how that process will go. It's a discussion that we have to have with our shareholder, which is the government. And therefore, right now, the urgent matter is for us to get the fiscal program underway and going, and then we will address the issues of the central bank recapitalization. But in the process of time, I'm sure we will share that information with you in terms of how we propose that the bank be recapitalized going forward.
I know earlier you mentioned, or you answered a question in relation to the negotiations with the commercial banks as far as the debt exchange, well, the debt rescheduling or debt restructuring is concerned. But among the information that continues to be put in the public's domain, the likelihood that if we do not conclude those negotiations with the banks, the people in Barbados who do business with those banks will be faced with additional charges, whether there be fees and commissions and that sort of thing. Do you foresee that happening?
I'm not sure. I think there's a little confusion. In terms of the domestic banks, the debt restructuring has been concluded.
Right. Okay. I'm talking about that has been concluded.
Yes, that has been concluded.
So why therefore are we hearing all this talk therefore that, you know, the banks could be charging or likely to charge additional fees and,
right.
And
so
that sort of thing?
So the two things. The debt restructuring has been concluded.
Domestic,
obviously, in the short term, those institutions which participated in the debt restructuring will take accounting losses. Because while there has been no write-off of the securities that they held, the terms of those securities have been altered. And the mechanisms by which the accountants report requires them to do what they call net present value calculations. And therefore, from that perspective, there are going to be accounting losses for the bank. So you might see that a bank actually incurs a loss or it has a very small income for the last fiscal year. Based on that, I think that's where the issue is being raised. Well, if they have taken losses, how do they recoup? And that one mechanism of recouping on those losses is through increased fees. Now, the truth is that we have been experiencing increased fees from the banks well before the restructuring, and the mechanism by which banks will be able to replenish their income relate not solely to increase fees, but their ability to do new lending. Mm-hmm. Because essentially that's the business that banks are in, the business of lending. So to the extent that we are able to strengthen the economy, the way that the economy is performing, it gives the banks greater confidence, it gives potential investors greater confidence to want to undertake new investments, and therefore it creates, from that perspective, income earning opportunities for the banks. But you know, that is really the best of all worlds, that we're able to get the economy moving in such a way that, you know, the banks and other financial institutions have an opportunity to not only to mobilize, but now to be able to invest the funds that they receive. But you know, there's always the possibility that they will seek to raise fees, because that is part of the business model that banks have evolved over time.
The bank allowed that to happen?
It depends. What we often say is the central bank cannot control all of the fees that banks have. What we do from time to time is that we look at certain critical fees and have a discussion with the banks and say, well, look, we think that, you know, you need to hold back on these types of fees. But if you were to look at the fee structure of an institution, you would see that there could be scores, probably hundreds of different little fees, and it's not practical for the central bank to be attempting to control each of those fees. It's almost similar to if you go into the supermarket and you want to say you want to control the price of corned beef, but there may be 10 or 12 different brands of corned beef. So you know, you can't control the price of corned beef reasonably if there's so many brands. And it's the same thing when it comes to dealing with the fees. But I think our perspective is that there are some fees that maybe impact the most vulnerable in society, that we will continue to monitor those, and if we believe that something ought to be done, we will indicate that to the banks. We've done it in the past, and I believe that we will do that in the future.
Joanne, and then Sharika.
On another matter though, Mr. Governor.
Mr. Haynes, what impact do you think the sale of Sagicor will have on the Barbados economy? Because you would have heard that there are some people who are looking to buy all the shares of Sagicor. What impact do you think that will have on Barbados economy?
Whenever there is a sale of a major company, it can impact the way that it is operated. There are no two ways about that. There will be initially some inflow of foreign exchange associated with any potential sale. And by extension, over the years, there will be outflows related to dividend payments, because now you are sort of more owned by non-resident interests, and therefore there will be outflows from that perspective. But I think as a company, the culture, it can change once you get a foreign buyout, and therefore one has to see how does that redound to the benefit of the company. Having a foreign player can often help you to get synergies that you would not be able to get if you were to remain as an isolated Barbadian company. And I think we've seen examples of that, where entities have become more profitable after they have been sold. So that can make you more competitive in terms of the international environment. But all of that becomes something that we have to watch as it evolves, because you don't know the nature of the change in culture that is likely to take place as a result of the sale.
Sharika?
Governor, the bank would have recently concluded its regulatory sandbox. Can you give us some ideas to the results? What would have been discovered?
Well, I think what I would want to do is to, because I think we are in the process now of going over that report, and we have to have discussions with the entities are involved. So I wouldn't want to say anything publicly at this time until we've had a chance to have those discussions with them. I don't think that would be fair to them to discuss it in public before we've had a chance to really discuss it with them.
And Joel?
Yeah, Governor, we are looking to grow the Barbados economy and put it on a path of, well, on a sustainable path. Would you at this stage though prefer to see more investments in foreign exchange earnings, in the foreign exchange earning sectors of the economy, rather than the foreign exchange using sectors of the economy? Because at the end of the day, the foreign exchange using sectors are going to be eroding our what little foreign reserves we have. And you know, it has always been the case that we should look to earn more foreign exchange. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, I can't argue with that suggestion. We need to earn more foreign exchange, and therefore we want our investment to be in the foreign exchange earning sectors. We must recognize that foreign exchange using sectors support foreign exchange earning sectors, so you will have activity in your foreign exchange using sectors also. But what is critical for you to go forward is that you need that investment in your foreign exchange earning sectors, because without it, if you're solely reliant on foreign exchange using services, then you will see a diminution of your reserves. If you have both of them going together, then the probability of your reserves going up are significantly enhanced if your foreign exchange earning sectors are bringing foreign exchange, both through investment, but also through the generation of income from the sales of their goods and services.
Well, thank you very much, members of the media, and the Governor, we invite your final comments today.
Well, my final comment really is captured in the press release itself. The road remains challenging. We're not yet out of the woods. We're making good progress, but we have to keep focus and work together in order to achieve the objectives that we have set. Certainly from the bank's perspective, we believe that our objectives are achievable, but it requires everyone to, in a sense, put their hand to the plow in order for us to get where we want to get. And that, you know, this time next year, we will feel that we're in a much more comfortable position than some of you might think we are in at this point in time. So, you know, I want to wish everyone in the media a happy 2019 and look forward to sort of progress in our economic developments. Thank you.
And thank you, Governor. Thanks to the members of the media and, of course, to our online viewers and listeners. And if I may add, Governor, let us continue to be each other's keeper. Have a wonderful day, and as our governor said, all the best to everyone for 2019.